Good morning. Welcome to the gathering here at Kingsway Baptist Church on this rainy Sunday morning, but I'm glad you're here. And we're going to start by singing Thank You, Jesus, for the Blood Applied, a song we've been learning this year. Many of you know it. If you don't, of course, the words are up on the screen. Let's all stand as Brother Charlie comes and leads us in our theme song this
I was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. From the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. There at the cross you paid the debt I owe, broke my chain, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, then you walked right out again. Now death had no sting, life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. There's nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. The blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood. The blood. There is nothing stronger than the wonder-working power of the blood. The blood that calls us sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our Father through the blood. The blood. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name.
Amen. Glory to His wonderful and glorious and holy name. To God be the glory. Thank you for being again with us today. We do have some special guests with us that I want you to meet before we open in prayer. And so we have Bill and Sharon back here from Mickleton. Just slip your hands up. Let's give them a hand. Thank you for being with us today. And Bill was telling me they live on Gaunt Drive. And Tia, we had some founding members that were the Gaunts. Howard Gaunt. Okay, I couldn't remember. And the Gaunts are in heaven now, but they lived on Gaunt Drive, and that was their family was named after them. And the Gaunts were the ones who planted some of these massive trees. They were just little trees when we first purchased this property as a church in the 70s, and they planted some trees, and now they get to look on from heaven at us and the trees they planted. But so good to have you, Bill and Sharon. Thank you for being with us today. We trust you're blessed. And let me see, is there anybody else? I don't think I see any other first-time guests. Let's start with a word of prayer, and then we can be seated, and we'll sing some more to our great God in heaven. Lord, I just thank you for your Son, Jesus, and for the blood, and not just the blood, but the blood applied to our lives. Thank you for those that have placed their faith and trust in Jesus. And as we'll see today, in Jesus alone, in our text in Philippians 3. And I pray that, Lord, we would be challenged. Lord, I know it's a rainy morning, and some of us woke up, and we weren't too thrilled about the weather. But, Lord, the truth of the matter is, the farmers are grateful. And, Lord, the flowers are grateful. And the rain is grateful. And the trees are grateful. And, Lord, I know some people are thinking they can't be grateful, but you said in your word that they could, Lord, shout out your praise, and they can, Lord, glorify you, that all creation can lift its voice in wonder to you. So I pray that, Lord, on this rainy day, we would praise you, whether it's rainy or sunny, whether it's stormy or serene. Lord, I pray that we would just lift our hearts to you. We'd lift our hearts to your Son, that we'd be filled with your Spirit. I thank you for our guests today, Bill and Sharon. I pray you encourage them. Thank you for our members that are here faithfully. Be with those, Lord, that are sick. I know there's several families and several members that are sick and just can't be here. And of course, we want them just to be at home, getting better. And we pray that you'd strengthen them. They might be on the live stream today, Lord. I pray you'd encourage their heart, even from afar. I thank you for, Lord, the people in this community, many who have registered for our summer soccer camp. And we'll have, Lord, almost 100 children on this property next week. And many, many parents will be here, and some of them for the first time. And I pray that they would, Lord, feel the love of Jesus. I pray that they would feel a warm welcome, and that we know that not only do we love their children, but we love you, and we love your word. And we want, Lord, people to know the gospel. And so, God, thank you for the gospel. It is by the gospel we're saved. And I pray that we'd never get away from preaching the old-time truths that Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Lord, glory to your wonderful and holy name. Bless our time. Please, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated tonight.
Take your hymnal, please, and turn to number 43. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. That's number 43.
Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Lift His banner, let the anthem ring. Praises to our mighty King. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Sing to Jesus with a song of praise. Sing to Jesus with praise. Sing to Jesus with a song of praise. Sing to Jesus with praise. Fill the heavens with a mighty voice. Bless His name, let all rejoice. Sing to Jesus with a song of praise. Sing to to Jesus with praise.
All right, now we'll sing He is Worthy. The words will be on the screen in just a minute. Stand before His majesty, beautiful beyond our highest thought. Worthy, He is worthy. Holy, holy is the Word made flesh. King who bore our pain and poverty, come to claim the rebel and the wretch. Worthy, He is worthy. All glory and honor, all power and praise be to Your name, be to Your name. For no one could rival Your glory and fame. We lift high the name of Jesus. Holy, holy is the Lamb who died, canceling our debt at Calvary, rising from the grave to reign on high. Worthy, He is worthy. All glory and honor, all power and praise be to Your name, be to Your name. For no one could rival Your glory and fame. We lift high the name of Jesus. Holy, holy, Lord Almighty, worthy is Your name. Holy, holy, none beside You, greatly to be praise. Holy, holy, Lord Almighty, worthy is Your name. Holy, holy, none beside You, greatly to be praised. All glory and honor, all power and praise be to Your name, be to Your name. For no one could rival Your glory or fame. We lift high the name of Jesus. For no one could rival Your glory and fame. We lift high the name of Jesus. Holy, holy, Lord Almighty, worthy is Your name. Holy, holy, none beside You, greatly to be
grab your bulletin if you have one today. We're going to make some announcements this morning. Well, we have been working through, and I say we, I think some of us have been working through. I want to encourage you. Thy word have I hid in mine heart. I want to, again, here we are in June, almost halfway through the year. If you have memorized and have quoted at least one verse to the church family, would you slip your hand up? Slip your hand up. Come on, slip it up. Okay. That's a good number of you. You can put those hands down. Now, the rest of you, I want to encourage you to be a part of this. I've encouraged you every week. It's not too late to begin. And so my next verse that I'm working on, verse number 56 of the 100, is John 3:16. So pray for me. I've got that's the next verse. But I know some of you are laughing and say, okay. But I have memorized 55 before that. And so, and got up and quoted. So I want to encourage the rest of you. Some of you are so close to finishing up the memory club that you're in, and you're about ready to get to the next one, the next level. So I want to encourage you to continue memorizing those. We've been singing the chorus associated with Psalm 119:11, our theme this year. Let's sing it this morning. Let's do that together. Ready? Thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. That I might not sin, that I might not sin, thy word have I hid in mine heart. Amen. I don't know about you, but I have seen just even this year in my life, memorizing scripture has drawn me closer to the Lord. And anytime you're drawn closer to the Lord, it's going to help keep you from sin. So I want to encourage you to be working on those scriptures. We have another backyard Bible study this Wednesday, 7 p.m. It's going to be at the Bartow residence, and I'm super excited about this. We had a great turnout this last Wednesday night. It was just a beautiful evening, and so I want to encourage you. The address is in the bulletin. Bring a camp chair, bring a Bible, and bring a good spirit. We usually meet for about an hour, and so try to be on time. We try to start right at 7 as much as possible. And so we have light for this, and it'll be a nice time at the Bartow residence. And I got a call this week, Jonathan Heather, from a family in this area that was just calling out of the blue. They were calling church to see if any churches had outdoor services. And so I called them back, and they weren't calling because of COVID concerns, but one of the family members is immunocompromised. And so I got to share with this couple about our backyard Bible study, and the lady just lit up, and she was so thrilled to hear, and she's hoping that her and her husband are going to come and visit with us. So here again, another good reason to have an outdoor, but it was a wonderful time. I want to encourage you to come to that. And Jonathan and Heather, if it's too long for the Millers to come to walk, we'll drive down to your house, okay? Some of you will get that a little bit later. Now tonight, when I greeted everybody this morning, I said, at the very end of my statement, I said, it's good to have you this evening. I was already thinking about my message tonight. Some of you didn't catch it, but here's the message tonight. 2 Samuel 12, a confronting, chastening, confession, comforting, and crown. It's all from 2 Samuel 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12 is a very, very important message or chapter after David commits his sin, the great sin that he's known for. And here's the reason. Here's what separates David from most everybody in the Bible. Everybody in the Bible is a sinner, just like everybody in this room is a sinner. But it's how, what you do when you're confronted with your sin that separates you from other Christians. And we're going to learn tonight about a confronting, and what did David do when he was confronted? Because this changed the direction. And it's very, very important, his response. And so I want to encourage you tonight. Every one of you are confronted by your sin. Now, some of you aren't paying attention to me. You're looking at something else. You're not paying attention. Every single one of you are confronted by your sin in a certain way. It might be during a message. It might be the Holy Spirit. It might be reading the Word of God. It might be a message that you hear. It might be a text that someone sends you. It might be a friend that confronts you about something you're involved with. What do you do the moment you're confronted? This will separate you, the Christians who decide to go on and actually become better Christians, or those who wallow in their Christianity and struggle. And we're going to look at that tonight. And this is what separated David and really, in my opinion, made him a man after God's own heart. So I want to encourage you tonight, 6 o'clock. I want to encourage you to be here. Well, there's a bunch of other things in the bulletin. Next week is Father's Day, And we're going to honor our fathers. Of course, we'll honor our Heavenly Father most of all, but all the fathers that will be here, we will honor. There will be no evening service, and then a week from tomorrow is our summer soccer camp. We've got some other things. I do want to draw your attention to the Freedom Service at the Lake in the bulletin, July 3rd. That is going to be on a Sunday morning. Of course, it's the day before the 4th. Last year, the 4th was on a Sunday, and we had a Freedom Service at the lake, Lake Silvestro, right on Tomlin Station Road. We have reserved that again this year for July 3rd. We will have just one morning service. We'll let you know next week the time that'll begin. It'll be either 10 or 10:30. And we'll have a big potluck afterwards. We'll bring a bunch of food. We have Mr. Softy coming again to the lake. And we're just going to have a Freedom Service. We'll sing patriotic songs. I'll bring a patriotic message. We will have a great time at there won't be any church service here. It'll be outdoors at the lake, and it'll be a wonderful time. So if you're here that weekend, not out on vacation or something, we'd encourage you to be here. Maybe invite a friend, a neighbor, a loved one to a Freedom Service at the lake. There are some birthdays in the bulletin that are upcoming, some anniversaries. Matter of fact, Mike and Gina just celebrated an anniversary yesterday, and John and Barbie celebrate an anniversary tomorrow. John, how many years? 24. Let's give John and Barbie a hand. That's awesome. We make a big deal about marriage around here, and so I think Mike and Gina were celebrating 11 yesterday, and you folks are celebrating. So one more year, Brother John, until the big 25, okay? You get to prepare for a year for that. And very happy for you and Barbie, 24 years, happy anniversary. It is time for our offering today. And so Brother Jonathan Bartow is going to lead us. We have a different man every week who's going to been leading us in our prayer for offering. I appreciate the Bartows. They're the ones that are going to hold the Backyard Bible Study at this week's midweek Backyard Bible Study. But I appreciate Brother Jonathan not just because he plays the guitar, although he does, not because he leads his family to church, although he does, but because he's been a friend to our family and a personal friend to me, and I appreciate his love for the Lord. He's going to come and lead us in our prayer for today's offering.
So this is a little more than a prayer. I was thinking of what I could share when the pastor asked me to do this. So I like history. Who here has heard of the name of R.G. Letourneau? Anybody? Okay, good. There's a few hands I see there. So Robert Gilmore Letourneau, who lived from 1888 to 1969, there's a Christian university named after it. I had the privilege of going there for about a year and a half. Their main emphasis is in engineering, aviation, and such. But I wanted to read a little short story about him as it relates to giving. If you've ever been part of a church fundraising campaign, you've likely heard the name R.G. Letourneau. His story of giving is the stuff capital campaigns are made of. However, the story of why he and his wife, Evelyn, chose to give away 90% of their wealth and the life-changing decision that prompted it is rarely told. Letourneau was one of the more unlikely leaders of the 20th century industry. From humble beginnings in his seventh grade education, he taught himself engineering and eventually built a manufacturing empire. His earth-moving machines helped win World War II and construct the highway infrastructure of modern America. By the end of his life, he held more than 300 patents. He had also become one of the leading spokespersons in the lay-led faith and work movement. The decision to give away 90% of his personal income and stock in the company was the result of a previous decision made when he was 30 and deeply in debt to make God his business partner. Chastised by his missionary sister to get serious about serving God, Letourneau was confused. Like most people, he believed that sincere dedication to God required that he become a preacher, an evangelist, or a missionary. He attended a revival meeting at church and gave in. Thinking he was headed to the mission field, he sought guidance from his pastor. After praying together, his pastor said, "You know, Brother Letourneau, God needs businessmen as well as preachers and missionaries." Letourneau responded, "All right, if that's what God wants me to be, I'll try to be his businessman." Letourneau took his business partnership with God seriously. Although he felt like God was getting a sorry specimen as a partner, when financial success came years later, he believed this made him a debtor to God as well as his fellow man. His commitment to give away so much of his wealth was not a flash of generosity as much as a logical progression from his earlier decision to make God his business partner. When people understand that their work matters to God and recognize that he is their business partner, Letourneau's perspective is a natural response. The question is not how much of money I give to God, but rather how much of God's money I give for myself. What would it mean if you recognize that God is your business partner? How do you view money? As a measurement of your worth or a tool for serving God and others? So this is one of the things I've been trying to instill in my boys. They recently started doing lawns, a couple neighbors' lawns. I've been challenging them to, you know, it's great that you have that opportunity to make money, but give back to the Lord, you know, because he gave to you. And I've seen it over the years, especially in particular my family, and when my parents were short on money, you know, and they, you know, it's a tough decision sometimes. You want to just kind of keep things close, and they always made it a priority to give at least 10%. And I saw so many times where my mom would go to the store and something would be like marked down, and just the Lord does give back. He does honor his promises, and praise God for that. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you so much for all that you give us. Help us to realize that we are partners with you. Knowing you as our personal Savior and Lord, we're partners in everything, Lord. And help us to learn to give back, Lord, to what you've already given to us. And bless it to your service. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
In your hymnal, number 38, How Great Thou Art. It's number 38. I'll ask you to find that and stand with me, please.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. thou art, verse 2. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the bird sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Verse 3. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Remain standing, please.
Good morning. As we prepare for Pastor Josh's message, we'll continue in Philippians. Please join me in turning to Philippians chapter 3. We'll read verses 8 through 12. Chapter 3 in Philippians, verses 8 through 12. I'll start in verse 8, congregation, verse 9, so forth and so on. And then as we wrap up in verse 12, congregation, please join me in that on verse 12. Once again, Philippians chapter 3. Verses 8 through 12. The perfect and pure word of God says, yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for your people and your house gathered around your word. Lord God, I pray that you would just speak to us today. Prepare our hearts. Lord God, I pray those who have ears to hear would hear today the message that you have for them. Please bless the message that follows. Please bless the fellowship time thereafter. And Lord, we just give you all the glory. We thank you for your mercy and your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, Brother Brian, for leading us in the scripture. They're open to Philippians chapter number 3. You know, Brother Jonathan mentioned he got to go to Laterno only the really, really smart people were admitted into Liturno. So, and that's why he's an airplane mechanic to this day. But I read years ago the story, the life story of R.G. Liturno is fascinating. A brilliant man, but to me, more brilliant because he followed Christ with his life, and that was wonderful. Philippians chapter 3, I want you to stay focused today, and please follow along with me. I want to give you a reminder that the theme of this short letter to the Philippian church is joy in the gospel. Joy in the gospel. Matter of fact, I think, let me see it. Yeah, I can go backwards here. We've had this up on the screens here throughout each of these. And Paul is writing a letter from prison to the church family in Philippi. He's thanking them for their love to him. And he's also warning them of those who pervert the truth that it's Jesus plus nothing that saves. Jesus plus nothing that saves. It's not Jesus plus circumcision. It's not Jesus plus keeping the law. It's not Jesus plus keeping the Sabbath. It's not Jesus plus a sacrifice. No, it is Christ and Christ alone. And if you were with us last week, we learned from Paul's first few verses in chapter 3 that true Christianity counts differently. It counts differently. And Paul reiterated in verses 4 through 6 that if anyone was going to be saved by their nationality, by their religion, by their zeal, by their service to God, it would have been Paul. And he made that very clear. But we ended last week with verse 7. Now, Brother Brian started us with verse 8 today, but would you read verse 7 out loud with me together? Ready? But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Let's read it one more time. Ready? But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Now, today's title of the sermon is Winning Christ, Being Found in Christ, and Knowing Christ. And I submit to you that the moment you and I die, the most important thing ever is that we are found in Christ. That's the middle item in our title today. But winning Christ and knowing Christ are very worthy pursuits, and I'll explain. So I chicken scratched a picture that I've scanned and put up on the screen for you. Hopefully you can see it here. And as I was thinking about this and dwelling and meditating and musing on the message, I thought, okay, Christ, being found in Christ, it's the cross. It's realizing that Jesus Christ died on the cross for whose sins? My sins. Make it personal. For whose sins? My sins, okay? Always make it personal. You know, the Bible was written to you. It wasn't just written to the world, although it was, but it was written to you. In other words, it's God's love letter to who? Me. Amen. I like that. To me. And so the cross, I got to come to a point where I'm found in Christ. But this thing of winning Christ points forward to the cross, and this thing of knowing Christ points backward to the cross, but it all begins, or it all starts with being found in Christ. When you die, if you are not found in Christ, your spirit will wake up in hell. Now, don't choke. That's a word we use here in our church. Amen? Jesus used the word hell more than heaven. Jesus spoke about hell freely as much as he spoke about heaven. If you're not found in Christ when you die, you'll immediately regret for the rest of eternity all the times you rejected the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. You will remember the opportunities you had to place your faith and trust in Jesus. You'll remember every time you scoffed at the person or people or friends who told you that you needed to be born again. However, if you repented and believed the gospel while on this earth, the moment you die, your body will be dead, but you will be with Jesus Christ. If you placed your faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ, thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied, right? If you believed on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, which is the good news, then you'll be found in Christ, and you'll be forever with him in eternity. And so, as I've just stated, the gravity and seriousness of being found in Christ cannot be overstated. of being saved. That's why it's so important to know Jesus as your Savior. Hallelujah, glory to God. I'm thankful that Howard and Mrs. Gaunt knew Jesus Christ, their Savior, and they're in heaven, amen? I'm reminded, I look at our friends Bill and Sharon here, and I'm reminded they are in heaven today, listening to my sermon today. You say, how do you know my sermon? Because why else would they listen to anybody else's sermon, amen? It was thrilling to hear it last Sunday afternoon, and I don't know where he is today, probably because I put him in my sermon. That's why he's not here today, right? He's been here every week, but yet last Sunday afternoon, Justin trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior. Isn't that awesome? That's a young man who's been coming to church, and Jonathan texted me last Sunday afternoon. He's been raising his hand the last couple weeks. Jonathan texted me and said, Justin just placed his faith in Jesus. I'm like, woo, praise the Lord. He's found in Christ. But I want you to notice here now, the whole title is Winning Christ, Being Found in Christ, and Knowing Christ. Now, I want you to look three items in our text, and we read verse 7 out loud, which was from last week's sermon, but Paul takes it up a notch from verse 7 when he says, all things that were gained to me, those I counted lost for Christ, he ratchets it up a little bit. I want you to look it with me in verse number 8, and this is where we see the term winning Christ or to win Christ, and I'm going to explain what that means to you. Look at verse 8, yea, doubtless. So he says, if you didn't understand or if you didn't catch verse 7, he says, let me expound on that a little bit. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss. What things did Paul count but loss? Help me. I want to make sure you're with me, amen? What things did he count but loss? All things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus. And by the way, there's this glorious word, my Lord. Paul was making it personal. I hope you make the Bible personal to you. I hope you have a personal walk with you, a personal relationship. He said, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung that I may win Christ. Now, not only all the items he mentioned in verses 5 and 6, we went through those last week. Verse 8, he says, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. In other words, his religious training, okay? His religious training, he says, I'm going to use these books as religious training. He says, I count those things, all the books and all the times I went to school and all the times I sat at Gamaliel's feet and learned from the greatest Pharisee in all the land. He says, I count that as loss. He says, all the church, I got a little church here, all the religion, He says, I count that but loss. His love for God. I got a little heart here. He says, my love for God, because don't tell me that Paul didn't love God before he was saved. There's a lot of people that are unsaved. They'll tell you they love God. And he says, I count that. He just didn't know God. He says, I count that but loss. His nationality. See, if you remember last week, he made a big deal that he was not a half Hebrew. He was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. He was the real deal. He was an Israelite, not just an Israelite. He was a Benjaminite. He was from the tribe of Benjamin, one of the favorite tribes. And he said, I count that but loss. And so I'm using an American flag. Now, please don't get upset at me. We had one of these things break this last week. And so I'm using this. I was already going to throw this away and, or, you know, I'll dispose of it properly, but I'm using illustration, so please, we're very careful with the flag around here, but please understand, I'm using this as an illustration here today. He says, I count my nationality as loss, and he throws it on the pile. All things would include his wallet, his money. He says, all things, not just the things I've listed, but my money, it really doesn't matter in God's sight. His status. I have here a certificate of license when I was called to preach the gospel. And I have some, also some, what are these called? called when you graduate from college. Diploma, those big words throw me, amen? And I got this, and this represents when I was called to the gospel ministry. And Paul says, my status, he says, all those things are lost. All these things are but lost so that I could have knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. And then he makes this statement in verse 8. He says, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. Now, I want you to follow me very closely. And it's hard for us living in 21st century America to really imagine this. Paul had lost everything at this point in his life. Everything. His status as a Pharisee, his salary. By the way, Pharisees made pretty good money, especially compared to the average person. That he had lost his salary. He had lost his nationality, so to speak. True Israelites looked down on him because he was now a follower of Jesus, of the way. He had lost his religion. He had lost his freedom. Remember, do you remember where Paul is writing this from? Was he writing from the Surfside, Copacabana? Anybody? He was in prison. He'd lost his freedom. He had lost his academia. I mean, although he still knew everything that he knew, it really didn't matter for much anymore. Hey, let me ask everyone here, have you suffered the loss of all things for Christ Jesus, your Lord? Have you? I sure haven't. I haven't. I ask you this question. If today you became the Old Testament man Job and everything that he lost, if that happened to you today, if today, as you were leaving out the back door, somebody came to you and said, by the way, I was just coming by your house and it burned down. I just wanted to get here and let you know your house burned down. And while you were leaving, your boss pulled up and said, by the way, our company just went bankrupt and you just lost your job, Jonathan. And maybe your kids were spending the night at someone else's house, and maybe as you were already perplexed about that, as you're driving down the road, you get a call, and because you have hands free, right? You're answering it with hands free, so you're safe on the road. But you get a call that that the house that your friends were, your children were staying at, friends you trust and everything, there was this terrible tornado that came through, and tornadoes very rarely come through this area, and it demolished the house, and all your kids had died. I want to ask you this question on today, Sunday, June 12, 2022. Would you show up at church Sunday night and say, blessed the Lord hath given and the Lord hath taken away, but blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. See, most of us have had none of those things taken away, and yet we can't even get our butts here on Sunday night. Amen and amen. Hello. I'm going to push some buttons today. I'm tired of the apathy of the average Christian in America. And I'm talking to people in this right here sanctuary. This sanctuary right here. And I'm preaching myself because I don't want to lose the passion that, hey, Paul said I counted loss of everything. He's in prison. I've never gone through the things Paul has. And what do I have as an excuse when I am lacking in my Christianity? When you're lacking in your Christianity, I've not suffered the loss of all things. I can't even get some of you to look away from your phones and your Facebook and your Instagram, Snapchat, and whatever else you do on your phones during a Sunday morning service. By the way, don't think for a moment when you're looking down the whole time, you're studying your Bible. It torques me off, Brother Tom. I see people on their phones and they're not studying God's word, okay? By the way, bring a physical Bible, amen? Bring a physical Bible. If you don't like that, go pastor another church and don't say that, amen? Bring a Bible to church and look at it and follow along. You know how demeaning that is to a pastor who has pored over the word of God and studied for you to be on social media when he's preaching? It's like spitting in my face. You say, are you upset? Well, you determine if I am, amen? If today, hey, God have mercy on our souls. If we lost everything, I don't think we know the type of Christianity that Paul's speaking of here in this passage. It's so foreign to most of us. Now, you're here and you say, well, that's a good portion of Scripture, Pastor Josh. And yet our life, your life is so foreign to what Paul is speaking here. If he was here, he would question our salvation. He would, I don't think most of you are saved. You have it so easy, and yet, look at your walk with God. Now, I want you to look at the last part of verse 8. And if you're not mad at me now, you'll probably really get mad at me here in a second. Look at the last part. He says, and do count them but what? Dung, that I may win Christ. He said, all these things, yea, all things, I count them as lost, but more than that, they're like a pile of dog mess, dog excrement, dog feces. Hi, Linda. You awake? Ed, what's in here? What's in this box? Some of you don't know what's in the box, do you? Oh, yeah? It is. It is what you think it is. It's fresh from our dog alley, amen? You say, Bill and Sharon, I apologize. I don't normally do this, okay? You guys are guests, and God knew. But I'm making an illustration here. Follow me closely. Paul, it's starting to smell, by the way. And this is what God thinks of anybody who tries to count those things, whatever you're trusting in, to get to heaven. Because it's much worse than looking at Facebook during a message. It's spitting in Jesus' face when I say to Jesus, hey, I'm a good person, or I'm religious. Paul says, no, all those things are like a big heaping pile of dog dung. Now, don't get upset at me. It's in your text. Okay? Now, I'm not going to leave this in here. God at least gave me the... Nadine, that's the first time you said amen at the right spot. Amen? I'm glad you're here. And the Holy Spirit gave me wisdom to keep it outside. Amen? Now, it is outside. And only one person saw what it is. Ed, I'll pay you later for what I... for you... making the truth. Now, why did he count these things as dung, as excrement, so that he could win Christ? You say, preacher, what does it mean to win Christ? Well, we know that Paul knew about the Olympic Games that were held in Greece. He might have even attended some of them at the time. I mean, these games influenced his writings in the New Testament. He often likened the games to the Christian life. Now, would you get your Bibles turned to 1 Corinthians 9? Now, keep your Bible here in Philippians 3. But go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians 9, look at verse number 24. Winning Christ. Winning Christ. Look at chapter 9, verse 24. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain. Now, I just wanted to show you this verse, and if you were to continue on, Paul's liking it. He's not talking about a physical race, but he's using the concept of a race and winning the prize to that of the Christian life. He says, hey, I count all these things that were one time important. He said, like dung, they're nothing. Matter of fact, not only they're nothing, they're nasty in the sight of God if I'm using them for my righteousness. He said, and this is the reason why, so I can win Christ. Now, there are other places in which Paul alluded to the games and running and the like. The first time I laid eyes on Tia, I wanted to get to know her more. After the first time I met her, I wanted to go on a date with her. After the first time I went on a date with her, I wanted her to be my girlfriend. When she became my girlfriend, I aimed to ask her to marry me. Hey, when I asked her to marry me, I just prayed we'd make it to the wedding altar without her changing her mind. Amen? But on November 23rd, 1996, praise God, I won her hand in marriage. Woo! I won. Amen. Good amen right there. In other words, I pursued her. I won her to myself. And Paul says he came to a point where he had to lay everything else he was trusting in aside. No, he had to realize that everything else he was trusting to get him to God was a pile of dung. It was worth nothing. More than that, all the good he could pile up was like a pile of dung to God. Now, I don't know who here needs to hear that today. I wonder who it is that you grew up in church, that you grew up memorizing Bible verses, that you grew up in a Christian home, because growing up in a Christian home does not make one a Christian. It's very important for you to understand that. Your religion will not save you. Dr. J. Vernon McGee, that great radio preacher who's in heaven now of Through the Bible fame, he said he remembers hearing a preacher say this: when I was converted, I lost my religion. And a great many people need to lose their religion today and find Jesus Christ like Paul did. Hey, my friend, have you won Christ? Have you won him? If you have, then you're found in him today, and you'll be when you stand before him someday. And that leads us to point number two, being found in Christ. So look at our text again, Philippians 3, look at verse number 9. He says, so the last part of verse number 8 says that I may win Christ, comma, and be found in him. Verse 9, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. Now, this is the verse, verse 9, that came to John Bunyan, the one who wrote the famous Pilgrim's Progress, as he walked through the cornfields one night wondering how he would stand before God someday. He said that he suddenly saw himself not just as a sinner, but as sin from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. And if you read the testimony of John Bunyan, he realized he had nothing and that Christ had everything. And that's why Paul says right here, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law. He says, I couldn't do it because I can't keep the law. I try. How many of you tried to follow the Bible? Raise your hand. How many have been 100% successful at it? Raise your hand. None of you. Amen. And I add myself to that list. I can't do it. I try and I fail. I try again and I fail again. And in this verse, Paul expands on the notion of being found in Christ. There's nothing, not a zilch to do with being good, with having one's own righteousness, with keeping the law. We must have God's righteousness on our account. And that righteousness, according to this verse, according to dozens and dozens of passages throughout the Bible, is through faith alone. It is of God by faith. We need his righteousness, but we only get it not through my academia or for my nationality or the money I put in the plate or attending church, although I'm going to mention about something about that a little bit. That won't get me to heaven, or the books that I study, even if they're Christian books, none of those things. We only get it by faith, Ephesians 2, 8, 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So Paul was not just content to just win Christ. He was not just content to be found in Christ. See, if this were some of us, we would stop right here. Woo! Okay, Pastor, I'm saved. Got my seat in heaven. That's all that matters. I'm saved. But Paul wasn't content to stop there. And there's a lot of Christians today, man. They're happy. They have their name in the Lamb's Book of Life. But Paul said, no way, Jose. He had a little bit of Spanish heritage in him, amen? And he said, no, I want to know him. I want to know him. Now, knowing him, if you remember the picture that I drew kind of crudely, the cross in the middle being found, knowing him comes out of being found in him. So you've got to be found in him to know him. But let's look at verses 10 through 12, and this is the last point I'm going to go through today. Paul had a consuming passion to know Christ. Look in verse 10. Would you read verse 10 out loud with me? Ready? That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. Now, I'm not skipping verses 11 and 12 right here. I'm not going to be able to develop it like I would like to, verses 11 and 12, although there's some very important principles here. But I want to... This passage, especially verse number 10, is very popular in Christianity, okay? And so apart from its context, it's easy to read, but we need to read it, we need to think about it, we need to meditate on it. Here is vintage classic Paul, and a vintage classic expression of the New Testament view of the Christian life. What is Paul saying here? He's saying we should be finished with one's religious past, with one's religious heritage as having value before God, or as that having the means of a right relationship with God. It means to trust wholly in Christ. But I want you to follow me closely and follow very closely today. The ultimate aim is knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. not just being found in Jesus Christ. And a lot of Christians, they know they're saved, but what have they done for Jesus lately? How well do they know him since they got saved? And so Paul says, he that may know him and the power of his resurrection. He says, I want to know that resurrection power that raised him from the dead. And by the way, I want to suffer like Jesus. I want to enter into his sufferings. Hey, if Jesus did it, I want to be right there with him. He wasn't saying, hang me on a cross. He was just saying, I want to know what it's like to do what Jesus did. I want to know. Have you noticed in our journey through Philippians how totally Christ-focused Paul is? For him, the Christian life was not simply, it didn't end at the cross. It wasn't just a matter of salvation. It wasn't merely fire insurance to escape hell. It wasn't merely everlasting life. For Paul, it was ultimately a matter of knowing Christ. Here's the thing. Here's what I love about this. Brother Tom, you've been saved for many years, you and Linda. But when Paul wrote this, he had been saved for like 30 years. A cursory reading of this, you might think, well, Paul just met Jesus. He just got saved, and so he wanted to know him. No, he had known Jesus for years, and his heartbeat was still that I may know him, that I may know him. What he means is that he wants to know him better and better. Because if you love someone, then you know that person, at least to some degree, but your love for that person makes you want to know that person more and more. A good marriage uncovers to the eyes of one spouse more and more about the other spouse, as long as that marriage endures. Brother John, I know you and Barbie dated for quite a few years before you got married, but now you've been married 24. Oh, he's not in here. He was in here. He must have slipped out. Maybe he had to leave. Okay? But any of you that have been married for a length of time and you continue to know, it reminds me of the husband and wife who were at the dinner table one evening, and the wife commented, when we were first married, you know, honey, you took the small piece of steak and gave me the larger. Now you take the large one and you leave me the smaller. What's with that? Nonsense, darling, replied the husband. You just cook better now. Listen, this is the way that Paul views Jesus, okay? Paul is saying, hey, I'm going to spend all my eternity getting to know him better, but I want to know him now, and I want to get to know him now. And during my pilgrimage here on this earth, it's my delight, not just my duty, to know Jesus better and better. So here's some signs that show whether knowing Christ is a delight or a duty. I'm going to just ask the questions. Don't answer them out loud, but I want you to think about these because these are very practical. I try to make the preaching practical, like bringing a box of dog dung into the sanctuary. Amen? Some of you think, God, that's not one I want to remember, but you'll not forget it. Do you sing with intensity the songs of praise to God when you're with God's people, or would people think you're attending a funeral or an event you would rather not be at? Do you look forward to reading and meditating on God's word each day? Or do you often forget so that you can turn on the news or get to the video game that you want to play? When you're encouraged to be in an additional church service like a Sunday evening, do you raise your hackles or do you look for ways to attend the gatherings of God's people more rather than less? Is it a duty? There's the pastor harping again. Or is it a delight? See, when things are a delight, you're actually looking for ways to spend time with someone. Some of you have heard all kinds of stories of me dating with Tia. And when I dated her at PCC, and I only will say this story, and maybe you've heard it before, but we had a meeting with a pastor and his wife, a lunch outing with a pastor and his wife in the area this week, my wife and I. And so we were talking about different ways that they met and we met, and Tia brought up the thing that I had written her a poem on a banana. That's pretty, right? I was monkeying around. I really was. I mean, it was just... Where's Trevor, by the way? Where is he? He's where? Oh, what do you have on your shirt? Bananas? Okay, that's what I thought. So it was just a reminder. You know, I did a lot of crazy things in pursuing her. You know what? You want to know why it was, Brian, that I did that? Because I just felt it was my duty to do it. Was it my duty, Brother Brian? You know what it was? It was a delight. And you know what? I didn't care if the whole campus thought I was nuts. I really didn't. I'd care less. Some of you are so concerned about what other people think, you won't even open your mouth and sing. Oh, I wonder if someone, I can't do that. Are you kidding me? It's a duty to you. It's not a delight. If someone has to twist your arm about anything that's should be just naturally a delightsome in the Christian life. You know, Brother Jonathan, I appreciate that story about our L.G. Letourneau. Most of us will never be an L.G. Letourneau, but we could have the principles, R.G. Letourneau, the principles that he had, we could follow some of those principles. And I love that because giving should be a delight, not a duty. Giving should be, Lord, if you bless me, Lord, if you increase me this week, I want to increase more to you because you've just been so good to me. And so we think about this thing of knowing Christ, this duty or delight. To know Christ and his work of redemption will engage our attention for eternity. And by the way, let me just say this. Some of you are thinking, well, Pastor, you enjoy singing. I just don't. We're different. Well, let me just say something. We're going to spend all eternity praising Jesus Christ. And I guarantee you this, if you're bored with it now, if you don't enjoy praising Christ now, you are going to be bored in heaven. I'm just telling you, the Bible's very clear. I'm not saying that's the whole everything we're going to do in heaven. There's going to be a good part of heaven where we're lifting our voices and we're praising his name and we're shouting his glory and we're happy. By the way, this little "that I may know him" should be the tagline for every one of us who name the name of Christ. And if it isn't, we ought to ask God to revive our hearts. If that's not our passion, we ought to be singing, "Revive me again. Fill my heart with thy love. May my soul be rekindled with fire from above." How many of you ever visited the Hers potato chip factory in Nottingham, Pennsylvania? Okay, a few of you. I have, and if you were to say to me, "Do you know the Hers potato chip factory in Nottingham?" I would say, "Yes, I do." And no, I do not. See, I've seen the building. I've seen the tour. I've seen how those potatoes are cold and gathered and ready to be cut. I've seen the freshly cut potatoes on conveyor belt. I've seen them cooked and I've seen them salted. I've seen them come off a conveyor belt. I've tasted a fresh Hers potato chip right after it was, right after it was cooked. But to be honest, I really don't know all the particulars about my chips. I didn't get to see all the manufacturing rooms. I didn't get to see all the ingredients with certain types of chips. I didn't get to see the entire process. So you see, I might say I know the potato chip factory and yet not know the half. And even if I were to learn more, I'm sure there would be that much more to learn. And how many different ways there are of knowing a person. I submit to you this morning, there are so many different ways of knowing Jesus. It's a lifelong pursuit of going in yet another room and yet another room and yet another, still panting that I may know. One of the reasons I love David, I love the Psalms, is David had some of that same passion to know God. Psalm 42:1 is, "The heart panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God." I love that term, panting after God. Gives me a vision that someone that is running hard, pursuing God with everything he has. How many of you ever played sport? How many of you got to the end of a game where you are just panting to beat the band? Anybody like that? You know why you were panting? The person sitting on the bench wasn't panting. No. They weren't panting because they were cheering you on, right? You were panting because you were giving it all you had. You were playing to win the game, right? You were panting. And David said, I'm panting after you, God. I'm pursuing you. And so I ask you today, where are the passionate pursuers of Jesus Christ? Hey, where are they? This world's dying for some that I may know him, Christians. Will they be found right here in this church? Before he died, I want to give you a closing illustration. Vince Lombardi, the legendary coach of the Green Bay Packers, put into writing the philosophy to which he attributed his great success. The brief statement titled, "What It Takes to Be Number One," very famous words, is hanging on locker rooms, really all over the country, wherever football's played. Here in part, I'm not going to read the whole thing to you, but here in part is what Lombardi said. And I want you to get the gist of what he was saying, and we're going to apply it to the passage. He said, and I quote, "You've got to pay the price. Winning is not a sometime thing. It's an all-the-time thing. You don't win once in a while. You don't do things right once in a while. You do them right all the time. Winning is a habit. Unfortunately, so is losing. Every time a football player goes out to ply his trade, he's got to play from the ground up, from the soles of his feet right up to his head. Every inch of him has to play. Some guys play with their heads. That's okay. You've got to be smart to be number one in any business, but more important, you've got to play with your heart, with every fiber of your body. If you find a guy with a lot of head and a lot of heart, he's never going to come off the field second. Man, that's good. Few men live with such passionate commitment. And Vince Lombardi poured his heart and soul into the challenge of championship football for a piece of leather that gets kicked across an acre of pasturage through some plumbing. For what? And we have the opportunity, like Paul, where the goal is so much more compelling, to say that I may know him. And let me say to you, that challenge for Vince Lombardi ought to be permanently tattooed, if you will. I don't even know, tattooed, whatever you call it, tattooed on the inside of our heart, the locker room of our soul. And we ought to say that I may know him. So here it is. Being found in Christ, you can't know Christ unless you're found in him. And if you're going to be found in him, you got to win him. And you win him, you got to throw all this stuff you've been trusting aside. But then once you're found in Christ, make it a lifelong habit, a passion, a pursuit. God, I'm going to give it everything I have. Why should a football coach who had success down here on this earth be more passionate just about a game than we are about Jesus Christ? And I ask that question to myself also. And so I want to encourage you as we study Philippians. Here's Paul in jail. He's in jail. He's not complaining. He's not criticizing the government. Some of you complain so many times about the price of gas this week. Just being honest. Now, I don't like paying high gas any more than you. But did you complain more about the price of gas than you praised your God and Savior, Jesus Christ? My Facebook feed is filled, Brother Tom, with pictures of people, Christians. Most of my friends are Christians on Facebook, complaining about every time they filled up with gas. Now, here again, I hate that we're paying $5 a gallon of gas. But good night. Is that what your life's about? Is your life really just about who's in office and the terribleness of this and that going on? Are you serious? Apostle Paul is rotting in a prison. Nero is the dictator. He's about to have his head cut off, and he's not writing to the Philippian church, "Oh, poor me. I was fed beans and water this last week for the 16th time." No. What is he writing? "That I may know him." Here again, I submit to most of you, me included, that most of us have no idea the type of Christianity Paul's talking about, but I would hope to stir some embers within some of you. You say, "I want to know that kind of Christianity. I don't want to be the blasé Christian that's just found in Christ but has nothing to..." Don't know Christ. "That I may know him." Would you say those words with me? "That I may know him." Heads bowed, eyes closed. Father, you know the message I preach. I preach from my heart. Lord, I'm not upset at anybody here today, but I have a passion and zeal, Lord, for you. God, I want to bring a bunch of people with me, not just to heaven, but on the journey. God, I think sometimes, especially in some of our Bible-believing churches, we're very excited to see people saved, but Lord, we kind of check our zeal and it just becomes passe. God, deliver us from the apathetic Christianity, that laissez-faire, Lord, attitude that, "Well, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven." No, Lord,
May we have a passionate, burning, Lord, zeal that's alive to know you and to walk with you and to get to know you better. God, I would submit that the best marriages in here are those that didn't just, oh, they got married at the wedding altar. No, Lord, they've continued to pursue each other and continue to get to know each other better and to learn one another and Lord, love each other more. God, may we, those of us that are found in you, God, please give us a heart to know you. God, deliver our country. Most of us are concerned for our country, but Lord, I believe the answer is found in churches and found in people that know the truth. The world's going to be the world, but Lord, we're being too much like the world. Help us to burn as we walk out, or help us to burn in our hearts to know you and to put it into practice this week and next week and the next week. Oh God, please, I pray. In Jesus' name, let's all stand to our feet. God spoke to your heart. Piano's playing. I don't know how God spoke to your heart. But if you're here today and that message didn't even touch you and your Christianity is just, you know, it should be better, I would encourage you, do a checkup from the neck up. Do a heart check and say, Lord, if you weren't even stirred, if God didn't speak to your heart, if you just think you're fine, I would encourage you, get alone with God. Some of you need to come to the altar and just say, Lord, give me a heart for you. Give me a passion for you. Maybe some of you just need to slip out of your seat and say, Lord, I haven't led my family with passion for you. Maybe some of you young people, you come to church because mom and dad brought you, but there's really not a passion to read your Bible. There's not really a passion to know Jesus because you were just raised in it. It's just, this is what you were raised in. Can I encourage you, young person? Would you make it real in your life? Would you pursue him? I don't know who God spoke to today. If you're here today, you're not saved. Whatever you're trusting in. Paul said he counted all things as loss. Won't do you a bit of good. He counted but dung. How about it, Christian? How about it? Could have your attention. Thank you so much for participating in the sermon by paying attention and following in your Bibles. It's a blessing to have Amish food here every Sunday after the service. I want to encourage you to go down and get some. If we do not give it away, it gets thrown away. Bill and Sharon, thank you for being our guests. What a pleasure to have you folks. Make sure you get to meet Bill and Sharon. Brother Steve Burton is one of our newer ushers, and his wife just arrived in Brazil. You know, his wife, Giovanna, is from Brazil. Pray for Brother Steve and make sure he gets some of that Amish food or he'll be eating cereal and mac and cheese for the next 2 weeks. Amen. Brother Steve, would you lift your voice good and loud and close us in prayer? I want to encourage you before Brother Steve prays. Let me encourage you to come tonight. We've had a great, matter of fact, I want to just mention this to you. This year, I like to just track numbers because it's not all about numbers, but you know, if nobody shows up for church, something's wrong. And this year, we've had a better average attendance on Sunday night than we have in 10 years at our church. And it's been a blessing. Many of you have stepped up the challenge to be here, to quote scripture, and we've been. But I want to encourage you, the summer season's one where if we could lose focus. And if you're not on vacation, if you're on vacation, praise God if you're away. But I want to encourage you to come tonight. We really dropped off last week. We had fewer than we've had all year by far. Matter of fact, I literally thought, what's going on? So the rapture happened. And I want to just encourage you, as a pastor, God has led me to be the overseer here. We had a man visit last week, just moved to Mickleton. He said, I looked for churches that had a Sunday night service. He said, there were very few. He said, there was one in Millville. He said, one of the reasons we settled in Mickleton, Brother Tom, he says, because you have a Sunday night service. He came last week. He's bringing his wife tonight. He can't come. He can't be here on Sunday mornings. He works on Sunday mornings. Now, I know not every church has a Sunday night service, and I'm not blasting them. What I'm saying is we work hard to do that because we think it's important. So I want to encourage you, if you can be here tonight. Brother Steve, would you lift your voice, close us in prayer, and we'll be dismissed.
Lord, we praise you and thank you.
Amen. You're dismissed.